This video is on metallic bonding. Metallic bonding occurs between atoms of a pure metal. So if you have, let's say, some solid iron or some mercury, which is the only liquid metal at room temperature, or even between the atoms of an alloy. Notice the little dash here that I put in. That means it's not a compound. It just means it's an alloy, which means there's no ratio here. That's why it's not a compound. It's like if this is bronze, and you know there's different types of bronzes which have different ratios of copper to tin. All right, so what is holding these atoms together? What's connecting them? Because clearly if they're solid or liquid, they're being connected in some way. It can't be a covalent bond. It's not an ionic bond because you don't have a metal with a non-metal. You're not gonna have any anions here. Okay, that's not possible because metals aren't gonna gain electrons. What basically you have here is you have a bunch of metals and they all have this background information. We remember that metals tend to lose electrons, and they have an ionization energy that's low. That means they don't hold on to their electrons very well. So when you put a bunch of them together in a metallic, what they call crystal, what ends up happening is all the valence electrons, okay, that are not very strongly held, they're able to sort of move around in there, okay? So you get, but these little dashes represent, the dash represents an electron, okay? So these electrons are essentially mobile, and the description of the bond is literally you have a bunch of cations. I haven't said right. The cations are these metal atoms that are basically kind of letting go of their loosely held valence electrons, making them positive, right? Now make sure, because the overall thing is neutral, right? What we just have is we have these electrons that are able to move around inside there this way or this way. And so it's described as cations immersed, and this metaphor actually shows up on the reagents, okay? Immersed in a sea of mobile electrons. And this sea of mobile electrons explains a lot of the properties of a metal. Now, I'm not going to go into all the properties, but let me talk about at least two or three of them here. The first one, probably the most important one, is conductivity. And this is something that, you know, you're supposed to be able to discern that you have a metal when they say it conducts as a solid. And the reason why it conducts as a solid is because even in the solid phase, it has charged particles that can move. So, and what are the charged particles? Well, it's the mobile electrons. These mobile electrons, okay, allow metals conduct even as solids, unlike ionic substances or even acids in aqueous solution, which we know can conduct, but that's because of ions, not electrons. Nothing else has mobile electrons but metals. That's it. The second thing we can talk about, okay, is after the conductivity, we can talk about the malleability. Now again, malleability is me, if I can hit this thing with a hammer, right? I did a bad hammer, I guess, but if I slam, sorry, bad picture of hammer, okay, not the way you would hit it with a hammer. There's your hammer. That's terrible. Okay, they're malleable, okay, because if you hit them with a hammer, essentially the electrons almost act as a buffer between the cations, okay, which means the cations are not going to repel, because whenever two cations get close to each other, the negatively charged electrons are attracted to those cations, and they kind of move in between them and keep them from repelling. So the mobile electrons, those are, right, basically almost act as a buffer. Okay, and that basically, that buffer prevents, okay, a cation repulsion. And this makes them malleable. That's why you can bend them or hammer them into shapes and things like that. Okay, make jewelry out of them or spoons out of them, whatever. Okay, or wires for that matter. Okay, the third property which you have to do is melting point. And the only reason I'm bringing this up is because you should recognize it for a test questions. The melting point for metallic bonding is higher than that of most molecular substances, but lower than for ionic. So we're going to say these electrons, which almost act like a glue here, that hold the cations together sort of, right, because opposites attract. That glue is not as strong as the glue that holds a ionic crystal lattice together. So they tend to have, you know, moderate melting points, okay, which means in between. And there's overlap here. So basically, ionic is going to have something high, Covalent's going to have something low, and metallics are like just right. They're somewhere in between. Now, you should know a little bit about alloys, but not a lot. You should know there's two basic types of alloys. They're what are termed substitutional and interstitial. Really easy words. Interstitial means sort of in between. Okay? Substitutional means you're taking something's place. So two classic alloys that I can illustrate this concept with are brass. Now, brass is consistent of copper and zinc, these two elements right here. And they're right next to each other, and they're about the same size. So when you mix in some zinc atoms with the copper atoms, it's like they sort of take their place in the crystal structure. Because essentially, if this is a copper atom right here, and there used to be a copper atom there, and now there's a zinc, well, guess what? It kind of just takes its place because they're almost about the exact same size, and that makes it substitutional, that they can literally just kind of replace it. So if an alloy consists of, let's say, two atoms that are of similar size, that's going to be a substitution alloy, and you get a mixture of characteristics with those guys. Steel is like a really important alloy, okay? Weaponry is made of it. Bridges are made of it. Steel is a lot stronger and more rigid than iron is by itself. And that's kind of the nature of an interstitial alloy. Because what essentially happens is the carbon atoms, which are all the way up here, okay, are much smaller. So what they do essentially is they fit into the spaces between the iron atoms. So if this is like a couple of iron cations here, because we still have those mobile electrons in between, the carbon atoms are going to be like these little thingies in the spaces in between. That makes it a little stiffer, tougher to move, rigid, stronger, okay? So they make bikes out, they make tanks out, they make bridges out. Why? Because steel is stronger. Also, the carbon in there keeps it from rusting. So that's an extra added benefit, which means it will last longer than pure iron, which will rust and corrode much faster. Okay, next. The last thing you should be able to do is be able to compare them, because when you see a multiple choice question, they're going to ask a question like, they'll say, which will conduct as a solid, right? And so you're like, okay, what conducts a solid? Well, the only thing that conducts a solid are things that, as a solid, have a mobile charge particle. The only thing that has a mobile charge particle as a solid is a metal or an alloy. So for conducting as a solid, right, I'm going to put a little asterisk. Let me circle those ones, actually. We'll just circle the ones that would conduct as solids. So iron will conduct as a solid. Okay. Do I have just one metal up here? Yeah, I'll make this, we'll make this copper. Okay, so we'll have two of them now. All right, and this is an alloy. That, by the way, is cool. That's white gold, by the way. You mix platinum with gold, you get white gold. Okay, so that will conduct as a solid, and that's because these guys have these mobile electrons. They might ask you, you know, which of the following will conduct as a liquid. Now, these, by the way, will also conduct as a liquid as well. So mercury conducts. So let's make sure we're clear. It's not like metals conduct as solids, but not as liquids. They conduct as solids and liquids. Pretty much nothing conducts well as a gas unless it's ionized. And I'm not going to get into that. That's way off topic. All right. Conducting as a liquid, or AQ, is either ionic compounds or the weird exception, which is acids. So these are, and the big word you want to know is electrolyte. Okay. So these things are things that conduct as a liquid because electrolytes have ions in their aqueous solution. So NaO3 will not conduct, but it will when it's aqueous or when it's molten, right? NH4Cl, which is also ionic, will conduct as either liquid or as aqueous. Now make sure we're clear about this. Why do they conduct? Not because of electrons. They have the ions. So what's really important is you recognize for these guys, it's the ions. For these guys, the metals, it's the electrons. And the last one here of this list that will conduct is this guy. And we'll talk more about acids later. They are a very important group of compounds. And this one's interesting is molten hydrogen chloride, really. Okay. It does dissolve in water. And when it does, it forms ions, and therefore it acts as an electrolyte, and it will conduct. These guys don't conduct. They're covalent molecular substances. Have a nice day.